Let us advise the young people, learn, 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 let them answer what should be good, no? So the joke is the typical obscenity from the era, that they ask the three Marxist figures, Marx, Engels, Lenin, what do you prefer to have, a wife or a mistress? Marx, more conservative, says wife. Engels, hedonist, said mistress. Lenin said, I want both. And everyone stopped, like Lenin, the ascetic revolutionary power. Then they ask him, why? Lenin answers, so that I can tell to my wife that I'm with my mistress, and so that I can tell to my mistress that I'm with my wife, no? And they ask him, okay, but what do you do then? Lenin says, learn, learn, and learn. And that's the if why stands for traditional career, if mistress stands for all the small transgressions and so on, maybe the time is to say, I have to learn, learn, and learn. To withdraw, to think. There are so many things happening today, which I think undermine the very fundamentals, not only of our ideology in the simple sense, but of our basic perception of what does it mean to be a human being. Let me just tell you something which I hope you followed. I think, okay, I know it for over half a year, but a couple of days ago it was in the media. You know, at MIT, an Indian guy called not mystery, but mystery without E, mystery. At MIT presented a program called, you read about it, I hope you did, called Sixth Sense. It's wonderful. It's just a couple of things you have on your body. A small webcam, a cell phone connected with a computer network, a small web camera, a small digital projector, and I mean, I was shocked. Check it from the YouTube, you get it. It's breathtaking how it works. With this simple machinery, which today, when it's only in development, costs only $350. Even today, let's say I read a newspaper. I point with my finger and I see there a certain image. I point at that image, and immediately that image changes into a video which gives more data about this. I have a plane ticket, I worry if I'm late. I hold a plane ticket in front of me, and immediately I see on it 20 minutes delay. How does it work? There is a camera which is learned with all the machinery to identify works and so on. The camera interprets, gives signal to the phone. The phone connects with the internet and gets it back, and then the projector projects it on that very surface. And it works absolutely incredibly. Like, you get immediately the whole, you don't even need a screen. Every surface, for example, the ticket itself or every wall, can then serve as a projection screen. For example, to do internet, you just do this, you know, the F sign. You draw it. Camera is there to provide this and projects onto any screen that is there your internet surface. It starts to function, and then you type on it, the camera recognizes that. It's absolutely magic. But are we aware how this changes our entire interaction with reality? The revolution here, if it will work, it already works. But if it will explode, the revolution here is that till now, internet was experienced as something, a universe of its own. You know, the standard internet figure is some stupid jerk who is there alone, outside society, just immersed into the screen, isolated there. The idea is now to provide a kind of immediate overlapping interpenetration of reality and internet, or even to put it in this way, reality and the symbolic texture providing interpretations, reading, and so on and so on. The idea is, for example, I don't know, you walk in front of a moon, you point at a poster, and through this connection, on the poster you have it immediately projected, all the reviews of the film, the times off, and so on and so on. Okay, I wonder if it really already works like that, but it already works if it was not all a fake. But I looked around, I asked friends, they claim it's not a fake. You know what the mystery here is, that it's almost a magic experience where the way you experience it, all the data interpretations seem to emanate from the object itself. It is as if there is a table here, I touch it and the table tells me, this I am here, you know, and it, all these things are changing to such an extent, I claim, our everyday self-perception. And there's so much to do here, not in any conservative way like, oh, end of humanity and so on, but also not in the naive sense of, oh, what impossibilities, we will be like gods. We really have to think here, what are the consequences of to our self-experience of this, of biogenetics, of all these things. There are so many things going on today, and we need thinking to see what all this means. We are effectively disoriented here because the old answers, naively progressist, oh, perfect, we will all be virtual. And you know, this is one of the dreams of people like Ray Kurzweil and other techno-gnostics. Perfect, in 50 years we will no longer even need bodies, we will just be reduced to a program, software, just internally copying ourselves from one body to the other. Neither this nor the old humanist pessimism, the end of humanity and so on. But what is happening here? We don't know, so we need theory. I claim that we will need theory, philosophy even for our daily lives in 20, 30 years. So that at least should be good news for us academics. Thank you. I was too long, I know, but that's life. Be loud enough. Idea, because you know, first don't be ashamed of the United States. My God, I'm a Marxist, a communist, but I tell you, you are not doing so bad. For example, in my field, German idealism, you have now the best books, the best professors, better than Germans, better than French. Do you know that many German students, really many, are now going to the United States, especially to Chicago and to Pittsburgh, to study Hegel? So don't, I'm telling this, you this, as an old pro-European, don't be too fascinated by European culture and so on and so on. Europe is in a deep crisis now, especially what is still better than you, that's your weakness, I think, is your high schools. What is the best thing in Europe is, you know, these 4 years of what we call lycée, gymnasium, between elementary school and university. 4 years from 14 to 18, 15 to 19 of intense studies where we're all the basic general education and so on and so on. But at the level of universities, Europe is now moving in a copy of what was once the worst in the United States, this kind of a pragmatically oriented education. Not serving itself, it should serve the needs of society and so on, and it's a catastrophe. So that's what. Second thing, nonetheless, what is sad is that we, Lacanians, are dispersed. In the sense of, you know, there is one guy here, one guy there, but the same as that Starbucks coffee, where, you know, I'm almost tempted to say that today, the authentic leftist gesture would be, please, I just want a cup of coffee. I don't want all that, you know, helping children, Mother Earth, community. So you cannot. No, in the same way as there you buy all the bullshit, here also, you know, you go at a department, you get one guy, or woman, of course, and there are often women like John Kopchak at Buffalo, and then you buy all the other jerks at the same time. You know what I mean? It's difficult. It is difficult. So there are, you will not, there is not one place. Because in this is my answer to those more, some radical feminist Foucauldians who accuse us Lacanians of, you know, Lacan symbolic castration, you know, the father, link to patriarchy, legitimization of power. Wait a minute. There is, with the exception of your sub-department here, I don't know of any department in the entire United States where, to put it in very brutal, simple terms, Lacanians are in power. Vermont doesn't have only the only socialist member of We have it your sand, no? Bernie Sanders or what, no? You have only, also the only Lacanian. At least you are some kind of a boss here, no? Yeah. No, I really mean it. There is not one department where, but I'm not, now, I don't mean it in this stupid, you make fun, but seriously, where precisely, as you said, where you would get not just one guy and all the idiots around, but simply, you know, basically there are, for example, people know, if you want Frankfurt School Habermasianism, you go either to Northwestern or to New School for Social. You know what I mean? For others, it's clear, there are departments predominantly Foucauldian, predominantly phenomenological, and so on and so on. Unfortunately, we don't have it. So all you can do is pick out one of these choices and then try to wander around, first of all, you know. There are a lot of things available. There is some kind of a community, like that crazy old woman whom I love, my friend in New York, Josefina Ayala.com, where, you know, there are some websites which tell you what to follow, but unfortunately, you will have to work as a political, not terrorist, but illegal underground worker. That is to say, it will not be possible, unfortunately, to satisfy you completely with just the institution where you will be. You will have to look around a little bit. And I must tell you, even with jobs, be careful. I give you a brutal Leninist advice. Life, just to get the job and then cheat with the group. By life, I mean the following. It's very sad, but, you know, friends often ask me, or younger friends, to write a letter of recommendation. And I always warn them, like, are you sure my letter will help? Two, three of them admitted to me afterwards that they didn't get a job because of my letter. Not because it was a bad letter, but because it was my letter. So I'm not telling them, be a hero, sacrifice yourself. I tell you, be brutal as reality is brutal. Lie, tell them I'm not a Lacanian, I see your wisdom, you are right, and so on. Lie, work secretly as underground agent, and once you are in, start shooting.
Service, it will make you fit to function again. No, Freud always
dialectics of that the individual pathologies signal something more fundamentally wrong pathologically in the social structure itself and so on and so on. The problem is rather that I think Freud didn't find the problem is not social application as such. The problem is, and here I agree with you, the way he did it there. For example, superego. I follow here that Freud did, if you read him really closely, he, in many of his formulations, he has a very correct and productive notion of superego, which is simply not a stable thing. The agent, the moral agency, but a kind of a perverted moral agency. Freud, for example, always emphasizes that it's the typical superego paradox that the more you obey the superego commands, the more you feel guilty and so on. You know, this self-propelling, self-humiliation. So again, this is the good thing to clarify. For Freud, neither superego. Superego is rather, as Freud makes it clear, the law in its perverted sadistic aspect. You know, like, you fail and ha ha ha, the superego agency laughs at you for failing. But also the opposite of superego, which would have been which would have been something that Freud sometimes calls the ego ideal. Not ideal ego, but the ideal ego is the ideal image of yourself, but the ego ideal, the symbolic. Yeah. The first problem here is that, and Lacan was right here, Freud didn't even notice often the difference. Did you notice that not in Discontent, but in the other, his maybe key text, where things are almost right, but yet terribly wrong? The ego and the id, das Ich und das Es. There, as a title of one of the chapters, he even confuses them. He says the ego ideal, and then in brackets, superego. They are the same. So that's the problem with Freud. He was all the time inventing something, but as a rule, he wasn't aware what he invented and mystified it immediately. And I claim his biggest mistake, here I follow not only Lacan, but for example, Jean Laplanche. I don't follow him generally, but that's a wonderful book, collection of his essays by Routledge in English, translated as Essays on Otherness. He claims, and I tend to agree, that the duality of Eros and Thanatos is a mistake. It's a kind of a regression in some kind of pagan yin-yang dualism and so on. That there is only one drive, which is that drive. Drive is this, and this is another paradox. It's clear if you read closely Freud. Freud is here again confused when he sometimes, already in his Beyond the Pleasure principle, identifies that drive with so-called nirvana principle. This self-eradication, I want to die, disappears. But as it is clear, if you read Freud closely, what he calls death drive is the psychoanalytic name for immortality. It's something which repeats itself and, as it were, insists beyond death and life. Which is why I always claim that you should read Stephen King, you know, all this topic of the undead. The undead has neither life nor death, the living death. This monstrosity of beyond life, this is Freudian death. Sorry, so this is the only answer I can give you. In principle, I agree with you, but you know, Freud, basically, as all great inventors, didn't know what he was doing. He is still worth reading. You always have this game in Freud that he did, for example, another classic example. Freud, in one of his worst moments, says that there is no negation in the unconscious. In Traumdeutsch, I think, in Relation of Dreams. Okay, 5 or 10 pages later, he gives examples of it, no, and so on. He just had a certain cliché, prejudice of which he wasn't able to get rid, the prejudice that unconscious phenomena are some kind of regression to a more primitive level. He sometimes even compared, opposed consciousness, pre-consciousness, as the unconscious as speech and regression to some primitive, pre-symbolic level. But then, when he himself, Freud, use the as the model for interpreting the unconscious, the model of, how do you call this, rebus, you know, these images which have to be, how do you call this, you know, rebus, yes, you know, when you have a building of a house, blah, blah, but how do you read rebus? No, you totally abstract from the image, the connotation of the image, and so on. You have to retranslate word images into words, and then combine words. And Freud himself says, this is what happens in the dream. Dream is totally within language. Dream is not some kind of a regret. So again, you have all the time in Freud this tension. So here I'm for a kind of a Stalinist self-critique of Freud, you know. He had to be tightly controlled. But if you read him in this way, you still discover wonders in Freud. No? But I totally agree with you. For example, the problem is even how to read Totem and Taboo. This myth of the primordial father who had all the women. The superficial way, in the way unfortunately Freud reads it, is as an anthropological fact. At the beginning of human history, there really was a stage where the father screwed them all and so on, then the sons killed him. But what if we read it in a much more productive way, as a universal fantasy, in the sense of that this primordial, violent, brutal father is some phantasmatic entity, something which always has to lurk in the background of the paternal authority to make it efficient, and then we sometimes openly explode it. For example, I've written a piece about it apropos of, you remember, now it's already 2 years ago or what, that terrifying example from Austria, the so-called Joseph Fritzl. You remember the guy? You remember, Michael, it was in all the media, the guy who it was discovered for how long? 15, 20 years, had her own daughter in the basement, serially raping her 3-4 children, and so on and so on. This is almost like, I like even architecturally that, you know, ground floor, normal unit, father authority beneath the primordial father, and so on and so on. It's, you see here, you see that there was something to Freud's idea of primordial father. A dimension which brutally, in this pathological case, exploded. But a dimension which is part even of the normal image, or rather, of the psychic economy of how the function of the father operates. But again, we shouldn't read it the way Freud did read it, as prehistorical data or whatever. No? I even thought to mention the Hollywood classics from before, I even think that the fantasy behind that Fritzl family is not so much Nazism and so on as the sound of music, no? It's almost the sound of music fantasy of this Baron Ferrer, Gary Potter, mastering them all and so on and so on. You know that he had the children in and the wife hidden for 15 years, I don't know how much, in the basement, no? And you know that the kids are alive with the sound of music. I wrote an essay on this terrible Fritzl case entitled The Basement is Alive with the Sound of Music. So again, it's crucial to be quite like this.